Yeah, good morning everybody, and let me start by saying what a privilege it is for our group to have been chosen as the IAB Business Studies team for 2015. One of the core beliefs of this business, which has some very humble roots coming from a Greek immigrant family, is that we talk about famous brands being about a business that displays humility. And so we really are humbled to be recognized in this way by yourselves. And personally, I'm also humbled to be amongst 300 academics who individually and collectively fill such a key role in the development of our youth, given that education forms the cornerstone of a strong and hopefully one day very competitive South Africa. Or in the words of the late Nelson Mandela, education is the most powerful weapon that you can use to change the world. And every one of you here answered that calling by adopting teaching as a profession. You ought to be admired, and South Africa, especially commerce in South Africa, is deeply indebted to you. So I've been asked to talk to you this morning about famous brands. It's a business that I've been associated with for the past 15 years. And I call it a business that I've been practicing for all my life, given that my early life, as you heard, was spent blue-chip organizations like Distell, it's called Distell today, was Distell as those days, and SAB Miller. And as Debbie said, I regard SAB Miller being probably the finest business school in the world. It certainly is responsible for much of the success that I've enjoyed as an individual. But turning then to famous brands. Famous brands has probably been fairy tale, I suppose. A lot of people call it a fairy tale, but it's been a hell of a ride. And if you look at the title of the book that was published on our business in the late 2013, it talks about from Corner Cafe to a JSC giant. That is the famous brand story. It's a story about a business that started with a very simple Steers takeaway in Bellevue in the south of Johannesburg in 1970, and led to a business which was listed in 1994 by this very same family, whose name is Helen and Doris. 20 years ago, we were a business with an 85 cents share price and a market cap of a miserable 25 million rand. And we were a listed vehicle, and it was driving this family mad. They said, this just is not fair. We've been slaving away for 27 years. We've got friends who own spas who actually earn and are more worth, have got more worth than we have. We have to do something about unlocking value in this business. And to their great credit, especially the Europeans, they decided that we'll start to bring some people in from the outside world to help them unlock value in this particular business. And as they say, the rest is history. I was one of the early guys to come into this business from outside. And today it's a business where last night the share price closed at about 115 Rand. And it's a little bit more than 10 billion. Our market cap today is about 11 billion Rand. And what that is illustrative of compound annual growth in profits of about 30% over a 20-year period. It's quite a phenomenal achievement. But it's been a remarkable team effort. I'm just the front man for this business. And I can say is that at the heart of the success of this business has been this remarkable family. And we've assembled great leadership in famous brands. And so if you learn nothing else from what I'm going to share with you today about famous brands, then the one lesson that I think you can take out of business, and certainly it's been true for me, is that if you want to make history, then you've got to surround yourself with the best damn people. But if you have people, everything is possible. So I want to talk in a bit about famous brands. And what you'll notice from that slide is that there's a deliberate emphasis on the word growth. Because growth is in our DNA. It's what we thrive on. It's what we live for in this organization. So much so as what we did is we created a sub-logo. Even though it's not necessarily good corporate governance, you'll see that sub-logo in the top right, top more, my right, your right-hand corner of the screen. And we talk about famous brands as being a business that's about growth champions. That's what we do. That's what we wake up every day. That's what we get out of bed for every day. It's how are we going to grow this organization? We're forever setting ourselves new growth goals, always raising the bar. As I said, growth is forever on the agenda of this business, and I'm damn sure that when I show you the scope and the type of food service environment in which we operate, you'll understand why we're so optimistic about this business's ability to double its size again in the next 20 years. What does the business look like? Well, what the business looks like at the moment is by far and away Africa's largest branded food service franchise. Our business is different. I think last year you guys at Pick and Pay talked to you. Pick and Pay has got a franchising component to it. But our business is pure franchising. It's about people like you who want to be in business for themselves but not by themselves. And I think that's an important consideration in any business case. These are not people that work for us, they're not retailers. We don't own the assets, we don't own the bricks and mortar. They own the bricks and mortar. And our food service franchise business, which consists of in excess of probably 2,600 franchise outlets today, is underpinned by a very strong manufacturing and logistics business. Long ago, we decided to, I'll use the term lightly, control the supply chain. So we manufacture product at the back end of our business, we distribute it through our logistics centers and deliver that onward to our franchise partners. And we do that deliberately to control the quality of the product and also to make sure that our products at the front end of the business from a pricing perspective are always competitive. And it's a business that 20 years on the trot has shown record profit and record turnovers. And we will take to market probably by the end of May, our February 2015 results, and it's not insider trading, I can tell you is that the profits and the turnover for famous brands for February ending 2015 will once again be an all-time high. It's a business that has in its very DNA brands. Over the years what we've done is we've assembled what we call a brand portfolio, and our marketing people talk about the fact that our business from a marketing perspective, it's about a portfolio of brands. We play and we compete across a wide range of different brand categories, and I'll share some of those with you later. But that's been a deliberate strategy for us to participate across a wide range of different categories within the food service space. At the back of that business, as I say, is a very strong logistics and manufacturing capability. We are in this exciting space called food service. And our reason to be is the fact that we want to be part of building and broadening the food service category and positioning ourselves within the convenience space. And convenience is one of the key drivers in this business, and I'll share with you some data in that regard later on in this presentation. But we would never be anywhere near successful if it wasn't for those independent franchise partners who've invested their life savings, some of them, in a franchise business with us. They come to us because they hope that we can give them a better return on their investment than if they put their money in the bank. And some of them literally do invest their life savings with us. That our partners, we talk about them being our partners, we don't talk about them being our franchisees. They're our partners in profits, they're our partners in business. And we've also been very fortunate that our business model is underpinned by some fabulous strategic alliance partners in the form of the petroleum companies, big relationships, long-term relationships with the likes of Total, Shell, Engen. We've got fantastic relationships with the airports company of South Africa, so you'll see our brands at most airports in South Africa. And then more recently, we've taken over the branding job the South African National Parks, although sometimes we've got a lot of criticism for that, but I think we've made a fundamental difference to the South African consumers' experience in the parks and also the international travel. So we are a completely integrated food service business, underpinned by brands, and then very much our route to market are those loyal franchisees who get up every day of their lives, like they've done today, 365 days a year, some of them, to make sure we service our customers at the front end. I'm not sure how many of you have read this book called Good to Great by Jim Collins. I suspect most a lot of you have. If you haven't, I would really recommend it. It's a phenomenal piece of reading. It's about how you take businesses that are just good and make them extraordinary. Inside of this book is a very simple model, and ironically it's called Simplicity Within the Three Circles. And we've taken this piece of proprietary work and we've applied it to our business probably for the last decade. And so every single year at Famous Brands, as part of our business planning process, we will pull out this model and we'll start to ask ourselves questions about Famous Brands, because this model forces you to think about three things. That's why it's called Simplicity Within the Three Circles. And this model underpins the business plan for Famous Brands that we publish every single year of our lives. So the three questions I'll ask you is, what are you deeply passionate about? And it takes a long time and there's lots of robust debate about what it is that people will talk about. The logical thing that people will say in our business is customers, profit, quality, all those sorts of things. What we say is what we're absolutely fundamentally passionate about. Brands, it's our very DNA, underpinned by logistics and underpinned by manufacturing. Those are the three core competencies that we've developed over time and have positioned this business to not only play in food service going forward, but as I'll show you later, into some very ambitious plans we have for Famous Brands beyond food service. The second thing it says is, in business, what drives your economic engine? And for a long time we used the very simplistic thing, because it is about turnover. You know, when I was at SAB, I had some wonderful mentors, and one of them was Peter Savory, who was the doyen of marketing at SAB. And Peter used to always say to us young guys, is that, you know, we can have the finest fleet, we can have the finest manufacturing, we can have great IT, we can have fantastic HR, but guys, at the end of the day, nothing happens in business until the sales move. Until a consumer votes for you with their wallet and their throat, nothing else matters. And so we used to talk about what drives that economic engine is turnover. But you quickly realize when you hang your hat on turnover is that you can have good turnover, but you can have bloody rotten turnover too. And don't ever look at African Bank. I hope none of you are associated with African Bank. So we dropped the reference to turnover. Instead of turnover now, we talk about sustainable growth. We want to do things that's going to give this business long-term sustainable growth, continue to unlock value for our shareholders, because that's why they invest with us. And the third question is, what can you be the best in the world at? Of course, you've got to look at it in the South African context, because that's the landscape in which we compete and participate. And we would like to say is that within the food service space, what we want to be best in the world at is absolutely flawless execution. So whether it's baking bread at the back end, whether it's serving a customer at the front end, our business in Famous Brands must be about flawless execution. And it relates very much to one of the values that we have in our business, which I'll share with you just now. And then Collins will ask you to push yourself a bit further and say, well, if you do all those three things, then what is your BHAG? BHAG is just an acronym for a big, hairy, audacious goal. What is it, if you could dream out aloud, that you want to achieve? And make sure that whatever it is that you say you want to do is that there'll be a timeline attached to it, and it also be something that you can measure. So for us, Famous Brands, our big, hairy, audacious goal is that come February 2018, we want to have a business showing profit before tax of 1 billion rand. Figure that, from 1994 to 2018. It is a remarkable journey. The back end of it is proving to be a bit of a marathon, because getting to this number is not going to be easy. But we're making great progress. So, I say we use this model called Simplicity Within the Three Circles, so you can kind of think, well, damn it, business is simple, man. All you've got to do is this. Well, it's not like that. Because business is bloody tough. And it's really, really tough right now. What are the kind of challenges that business in South Africa is having to face today. South Africa is a country that's going to be underpinned by modest economic growth. The economists at one point in time were saying is that in 2015 we should achieve growth in GDP of 3.2. We will not come even close. And if load shedding continues in South Africa like it's designed to, we'll probably not become anywhere near 2% growth in GDP. Doing business in South Africa at the moment is not for sissies. We have a country that is plagued by political and social uncertainty. Look at what's happening in Parliament and ask yourself, would you invest in this country right now? It's becoming more and more difficult to defend South Africa as a market in which to invest. There's no question that disposable income from consumers is under pressure, and particularly what we call mainstream middle income South Africa. And that's the bulk of where the retail activity takes place. The people that have got money, they're spending it. I don't know how many of you know that the Porsche dealership in Johannesburg is the biggest Porsche dealership in the world. So the people in this country that have got money are certainly spending it. We see it in some of our brands too, which I'll talk to you about just now. But disposable income from the ordinary folk is under pressure. We've had some relief in terms of the petrol price. That's not yet beginning to see converted to spend in retail, but we hope that that will happen. So there is some relief. South Africa too, it doesn't matter what category you talk about, is becoming an increasingly competitive landscape in which to trade. All global companies are pouring into Africa. They all want a piece of Africa. I wish I had 1,000 rand for every column centimeter that's been written about Africa in the last 2 years. I could have retired long ago. Everybody wants to be in Africa. And everybody sees South Africa as the gateway or the beachhead in terms of getting into Africa. So whether you talk about fashion, whether you talk about cars, whether you talk about telecoms, and especially if you talk about our industry, global competitors are pouring in now almost on a daily basis. And more recently, we've had a deal with the likes of the Burger King, the Domino's, and the Pizza Hut. And that's not going to stop. So not only is the cake getting smaller and the fight getting more intense amongst our local competitors, but global competitors are pouring in here all the time. It's not an easy place to do business in South Africa. But it's not all doom and gloom, especially in terms of the category that we've chosen to participate in, being food services. Can we get chairs for those people now?
Can you maybe just raise your hand if there's a spare chair next to you?
There's one where I was sitting.
There's places here, Grant. There's a place right here. There's one in the front as well. Thank you,
So it's not all doom and gloom, even though it's a tough place to trade. And in the food service space, there's two major drivers that drive up our industry. And in the first instance, it's this thing called urbanization. And we're seeing continually people are moving towards the cities. All you've got to do is just look at the traffic. People are moving more and more towards the cities. There is a significant growth in the black middle class. And those people, as they arrive in the cities, bring with them new needs in terms of food service and new occasions. And we are certainly feeding off that from a Famous Brands perspective in a phenomenal way. So this whole urbanization plays very well into the food service space. The second part that plays to us is very much GDP dependent, but There is strong anecdotal evidence to suggest that for every 1% growth in GDP, there's a 2% growth in food service. Just to give you some data is that if you look at global trends in developed economies or first world economies, you'll find that 80% of all meals are either consumed outside the home or bought outside the home or both. People generally just don't cook it. That's a fact, because they're working like you guys.
Unless they teach us.
Unless they teach us. In the South African context, the number is as low as 30%. So figure, 80% of people in first world economies in the developing world eating out of home, in South Africa only 30. Look at the runway for a business like Famous Brands in terms of growth. The opportunities for us are significant. Yes, they are dependent on growth in GDP, but we're hoping, of course, in the long term that South Africa will recover and this will be a buoyant economy, and so we're well positioned to pick up on it. It's about what we talk about in terms of double income families. And when you have double income families, generally what you have is people are what you call cash rich and time poor. They don't have time to spend time in kitchens. And so when that happens, it's this whole move towards convenience, and that's where we sit, that's where we play. That's where we participate. So, I want to talk to you then about, in the Famous Brands environment, what do we see right now as those key 10 strategic thrusts? You go into business planning sessions, and you guys are going to planning session 2. And I mean, we come out of our session, and they are from the old days, no more, because our people help us with PowerPoints these days, but I mean, you literally used to have flip chart papers spread up all over the walls. And, you know, all that stuff is like a laundry list. So you've got to put it through a filter and say, well, what are the things that you have to absolutely positively get right? And for us, these are the things that we think we have to absolutely positively get right. Because in the first place, I spoke to you about the fact that our business is about brands. If the brand is unperforming at the front end, back end of our business doesn't work. So we've got to shape our brands, and shaping them means is that we've got to make sure that our brands all the time are contemporary, that they're relevant, is that they offer value, is that our franchisees deliver great service, because we are at the end of the day also about retail. And retail is, in our books, absolutely pure theatre. It's about going into a restaurant, even if you're there for 10 minutes, or if you're there for 2 hours, and being entertained. We've got to do that across every single touch point as that affects our brands. We've got, for growth, Famous Brands has got to continue to look at the back end of its business. And what we continually do is that we are always looking out for what we can do in terms of manufacturing products of our franchise partner. And so what we've done over time is filled the back of our business by getting into manufacturing. In the early days, it was very simple stuff we got involved in terms of making ice cream, making bread rolls, those sorts of things. And more recently, we've got a little bit more brave. And so today, Famous Brands does coffee roasting, makes cheese, does a wide range of manufacturing. I mean, simple things that we do that adds value and unlocks value for shareholders. Famous Brands uses about 1 million paper serviettes a day. Before, that business right now, as I speak, is outsourced to a third-party manufacturer. So we are busy right now in terms of taking that business in-house, so Famous Brands will get the margin and Famous Brands will get the profit. And why do we do that? Because we're securing on behalf of our franchisees to make sure we control the quality and we control the cost. So you keep on looking at the back end of the business about how you can fill your logistics centers and provide product to your franchisees. People often ask us about competition. I come out of an environment, SAB Miller, where we saw the beer wars. And we had a philosophy about competition that we apply today in Famous Brands. We say is that we welcome competition. He said, we think competition is good. Not only does it make you sit back and sharpen your pencil, but what it also does is competition in a category, actually what it does, it grows the category. So if the category is going to grow, and famous brands generally, as brands that are either number one or two in the category, we should be best positioned to go with the category. So we want to engage with the competitors. It's a nice way to put the fact that we want to screw them to death. So we want to engage with them, but what we need to do is to make sure that we talk about our guerrilla brands. And our guerrilla brands and famous brands are Steers, Wimpy, Debonair's Pizza. Those are big brands in our lives. They've got to perform. They've got to be fit for purpose. We want to build superior routes to market and make sure that we're the lowest cost producer. What is important to do that is in terms of building superior routes to market. If you're going to be successful in this category, you're going to have to make sure that your products are accessible and that they're available. And so what we've done very cleverly, I think, in Famous Brands, is we've played with what we call trading formats. So to give you an example, most of you will know a business called Mug and Bean. And Mug and Bean traditionally was set up as a business that was designed to go into major shopping centers, 400 square meters of retail space, 200 seats. And that was the Mug and Bean model. But that is going to restrict that brand to very much major centers, major cities, shopping malls. We've subsequently redesigned that model, and so we have a thing called Mug and Bean Light now. We have another product called Mug and Bean on the Move, and the Mug and Bean Light is a smaller version of the Mug and Bean that you see in the major shopping centers. And so what's that doing? It's opening up new markets for us that we could not get into before. The likes of Parkland, say, Bethlehem, Graaff-Reinet, Queenstown. You could never take a Mug and Bean there before. The economies would just not work. And the other thing we've done very cleverly, I think, is we're working with a Total Petroleum Company to put Mug and Bean brands on the forecourts of all their service stations. So that's what we mean about building superior routes to market, getting our brands into every little crevice that there is in South Africa. And we've got to do it on the basis of lowest cost producing, because our franchise partners, we sell them a business model. And that business model says is that the kind of return on the investment will be X. We've got to make sure that they get that X, and so to do that, because we're the manufacturer, we've got to do it at lowest cost producer status. You heard the fact that we're in Africa, we're in 15 African countries, we've been there 20 years. We think we know our way around, we are by far and away the leading branded offering in Africa. We're about to open in Angola probably in the next 2 weeks' time, and then Ghana is the only other country on our radar screen. Our strategy for Africa is what we call narrow and deep. We don't want to be in every African country across the continent. We want to be in countries where we believe there's potential for our brands. We go there with a very narrow basket of brands, and we want to dominate those markets. And Africa, too, is where we're facing lots of competition, and people think it's easy to do business in Africa. It's difficult. But over time, what we want to do is not only want to win the race to Africa, but it's about being first to Africa. And I think you can see, if you look at a retailer that operates in this space, ShopRite Checkers have done a phenomenal job. And we're saying is that we want to be the ShopRite Checkers of the food service environment. Broad-based black economic empowerment, it's not something you can wish away. It's the right thing to do. And so we continue to drive this behavior and culture within our organization. Yes, what we want to do is get our accreditation up, but we want to do it because it's the right, responsible, conscionable thing for business to do. And I'm very excited about the fact that we're about to embark on a program whereby we are going to do a share incentive scheme for our previously disadvantaged community that work with us. And that scheme will probably be launched in the next few months. And what it does do is going to give those people the opportunity to participate in the value creation of and a significant investment from our side, from our shareholders. I said is that, you know, if you're going to be successful in business, then you've got to make sure that you surround yourself with the best damn people you can find. And our group HR director, Arlene Goethe, is here today. And Arlene and I spent hours talking about leadership. about how do we make sure that our leadership are fit for purpose. We don't want our growth to get slowed down by the fact that we don't have enough leaders and we don't have the right caliber of people. And so we talk about this often, informally, but we talk about it formally 3 times a year. We have a thing called an executive succession plan, and we robustly examine every executive in our business, every middle management, and say, where are the opportunities? Ideally, what we want at Famous Brands is to have 2 middle managers waiting to become an executive. We're not quite there yet, but that's the goal. Because if you want to grow, you're going to need people. It's no good you buy the racehorse and you haven't got the jockey. You've got to make sure you've got both. We're going to be quite bold in Famous Brands going forward. Is that we say we want to expand our business through diversification. When we show this to the market, it was like shock and horror. Is that, you know, why don't you stick to what you're best at? And we want to do that. But it just so happens that Famous Brands is a business. If you're going to have a look at the numbers, it's a business that is highly cash generative. This business just pumps out money. It's the nature of the business. We have a business that can pay down debt very, very quickly. And as I speak to you today, Famous Brands is a business that does not have any debt whatsoever. It's a phenomenal position to be in, where you don't have debt. But what you can do is you can give it back to shareholders in dividends. And a lot of the family would like us to do that. But if you go and talk to the institutions and the analysts, they'll say, no, 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 don't give us the money back in dividends. Take that money and unlock further value for shareholders. And so what we're saying is that in that food service space, we think we've got great capability there. And can we expand the competitive landscape into what we call leisure? And I'll show you what we want to do in terms of taking a cautious step out of just classical food service franchising into a more leisure landscape. I'm unashamedly an IT peasant, and so when people come to me with money they want to spend in IT, my eyes roll over, but unfortunately it's a way of life. So we're investing heavily right now in terms of looking at our existing BoCraft software. We have a hybrid system at the moment, it's all over the show, but we've outgrown it, and so that burning decision that's been on the table for the last 3-4 years in Famous Brands about investing in a fully integrated ERP system, the common name and the brand that people know is called SAP, is looking at us right now. And we need to do it. It's going to cost a lot of money, but it's going to certainly improve our efficiencies and also improve our effectiveness and hopefully make our accuracy of reporting greater and also our ability to make decisions based on good, credible information. We can't escape. So it's about IT. And then, last but not least, it's about performance. Is that we want to make sure that all that stuff we want to do that is tangible is underpinned by a culture of high performance. And the other thing we do in our business twice a year too is a climate survey. And it's run by Arlene Worth in HR. And the one thing that our people feedback us all the time, sometimes it's not, sometimes perhaps I think we overdo it, but they feedback us that Famous Brands is a business where there ain't no place to hide. It's a high performance culture. We expect our people to perform, but then we want to make sure we reward them accordingly. So retention is a very big part of the kind of conversations we have. And I'm sure you want to know about brands, because that's what, as I say, revs our boat. And we've got really 6 things about brands. Is we talk about reinvigorating our core. There's no doubt if I use a simple example, I mean you all know the business called Wimpy. Wimpy's the kind of brand that's been around from the cradle to the grave. If you talk to people about Wimpy, they say, yeah, I remember going on holiday with my folks, we used to always stop at Harry Smith and enjoy Wimpy. But you can't have a business that's just, you know, still belongs in time gone by. Wimpy is a brand that's currently undergoing a complete reevaluation right now. The consumer has changed, the consumer expectations have changed, and so we continue having to reinvigorate our core being Steers, Wimpy, and Debonairs. Value is just another word for price, and value is the new black. Is that you are not going to compete in the South African retail landscape today unless you offer value. Or unless you've got a lot of ready money. We're talking to consumers that have got a lot of money. But mainstream middle-income South Africans are looking for value. You simply have to look at a business like Mr. Price. When I saw Mr. Price come out, I thought this model is absolutely price. When I saw Mr. Price come out, I thought this model is absolutely not sustainable. But it is a phenomenal business. And it is based on quality, sure. But value underpins that business and they do it well. And it certainly is something that we need to get our heads around from a marketing perspective and family brand as well. We want to win in growth categories. And there's no bigger growth category in South Africa right now than coffee. And so we've got probably four or five brands in the coffee category. We play across a lot of trading formats. And certainly coffee has been one of the things that's driven our growth to the extent that we now in our own roasting. So we want to make sure that we win in growth categories and be very well positioned to do that going forward. Lug & Bean is a phenomenal brand. It's one of the machines in our business and it's done a great job for us in terms of unlocking value. Building is one of the machines in our business and it's done a great job for us in terms of unlocking value. Building a premium contribution. We just so happen to have a couple of brands in that category. Some of you might know them depending on where you're from. But the three premium brands in our category are Tasha's, Vorbatello, and Wackerberry in terms of indulgence. They're not cheap, they're expensive. But go to a Tasha's, for those of you who know them, from 7 o'clock in the morning to 7 o'clock at night, you have to stand in a queue. I absolutely cannot understand how a guy who pulls into the car park at Village View, in Bedford View, where I live with a Ferrari, will come and get a piece of paper in his hand and wait for a place to sit. It's bizarre, but that's where they want to be. It's a premium offering, there's a significant margin at the premium end of the business, and so we want to continue to push our presence up at the top end of the market in terms of premium. And of course, there are two things that are driving that. Premiumization amongst upper income consumers, and they also talk about customization, about making their own. One of the weaknesses in our repertoire is the fact that we don't necessarily participate to the extent that we'd like to in what we call evening or sit-down dining. Most of our restaurants, other than takeaway, will shut down late afternoon. So there's a huge landscape, if you look at nighttime dining, the famous fans doesn't really participate in. We're doing some clever stuff now with Europa, which is one of our brands. And of course, we have a brand called Turn & Tender that does very well in the evenings, but they're small brands. That landscape is massive. And so famous brands is now standing back and saying, how do we participate in the nighttime evening dining trade? Because the upside for us is huge. It's certainly something that's on our radar screen from a marketing perspective. What brands are out there? Can we acquire one, two, three? Can we start something of our own? Can we bring something from overseas? All those options are what we're looking for. And then it's an exciting place to be because the types of innovation that you see coming across our industry are they happen almost at the speed of light. I mean, frozen yogurt came from left field, none of us saw it coming. Okay, it's gone up and it's plateaued now, but those are the type of trends that are happening in our industry all the time. And as famous brands, we want to be able to recognize those trends, see them coming, invest ahead of the curve, because when it comes to the branding environment, we say is we have to be number one or number two in the category. And that means about being first to market. So our marketing people all the time are looking at what are the new trends. Is it going to be sushi? Is it going to be Mexican? Will it be Brazilian? Is it about craft beer? Whatever it is, let's make sure we identify in the beginning first and we invest ahead of the curve. So, also what we do every 4 years in Famous Brands is we articulate a vision for this organization and we share that across the entire business. Is that we'd like to have a business whereby we wake one of our staff up in the middle of the night and say, hey, what's Famous Brands about? They should be able to tell you this. They should be able to relay this back to you. So this is brand new. It's just in the process of being rolled out now. We've come to the back end of one last year. So going forward, this is a new vision for Famous Brands. It plays to this conversation I had about the fact that we want to diversify. And it says that what we want to become is one of the leading branded leisure and consumer product businesses in Africa and selected international markets by 2020. Now, all those words were not dreamt up in a bathtub. They're deliberate. We sit and talk about those words all the time. So our business, we talk about leading. We want to be number one or two in the category. Our business is about brands. You see the word brand. It used to be about food services. We've dropped food services and you see the word leisure and consumer coming in. It used to be just about Africa. And we said, no, we want to be brave and certainly go into selected international markets. And of course, the board will want to know, so that sounds all very nice, given them, how will you know when you get there? So we say that we hope to get there by 2020. So all that stuff is very carefully crafted. It means something. It's not just something we stick on the wall at famous brands. It's designed to drive behavior. And how do we get there? You know, what are the things we're going to do? We talk about that being our strategic intent. Is our business is about building capability. You see, we talk about that all the time. Brands, logistics, and manufacturing. And we want to position ourselves to compete aggressively there in the leisure and the consumer space. So the agenda for us in terms of growth has been about building capability across brands, logistics, and manufacturing. We're absolutely obsessed with being close to our customers, which are our franchisees and our consumers. And to that extent, we went through a significant business model change 2 years ago. It was trauma, it was dramatic. We threw it now, we've got through the heavy lifting part, and our new business model now is designed to do two things. Get us close to our customers, and get us close to our consumers. We're passionate about flawless execution and continuous improvement. We talk about continuous improvement woven into the very fabric of the way we do things in Famous Brand. It's a phenomenal business, and I'm just privileged to be part of it. But this is a business where people talk about Famous Brands not as a job. It's a way of life for most of the people in our organization. We are a team of results-oriented people, and it's characterized by high performance. And where do we want to play? We want to do organic and acquisitive stuff in Africa and selected international markets. So we publish that too. So nobody arrives and says, well, you know, we think there's a great opportunity in Spain. We said, well, Spain's not on our radar screen, so go away, we're not going to have this conversation. So it's not stuff that's words on walls. All the stuff I'm showing you is designed to mean something. And then you also need to have a set of values. I mean, a lot of companies talk about values. Some people talk about what are the things you care about. We talk about our guiding principles or what counts around them. So what counts around Famous Brand? There you go. Very first thing we talk about, growth. We don't come and talk to us unless you're going to talk about how we're going to grow this business. Whether we're going to grow our people, we're going to grow our efficiencies, we're going to be better at customer service, how are we going to grow this organization? And we're in a position, as I said earlier on, in the food service space, where there's lots of opportunities for us to grow. And to do that, we simply need to leverage our scale and the strength of our balance sheet. Sometimes we get criticized for this and the next one, is that we're about speed. Is that we're not in the business of aim, and then fire. Sometimes I say we get criticized for it because we're about agility. In our business, even though we're a JSE-listed company, we're still very much a family business. And for us, we'll take our chances, but it's really aim fire. And we'll make a lot of mistakes, but hopefully we'll get a lot more right than we get wrong. What we sell people put in their mouths. You're only going to put something in your mouth once, it doesn't taste good, and you won't do it again. So quality is fundamental to us, but not just about the product. We want to stand for quality in everything we say, everything we do, the way we behave, the way we look, the way we interact with our stakeholders, and it's about being fanatical in terms of the detail. I spoke earlier about how important it is to innovate. We need to make sure that we continue surprising and delighting our guests that come into our restaurants So innovation has got to be woven into the way we do things. We want to be a business that broadens our competitive mindset more and learn every day. Integrity is critical. How can I look a potential franchise partner in the eye and say, invest R2.5 million in a mug and bean, and I'm going to make sure you get a better return on your investment than you put the money in the bank if I know the business model is flawed? We have to behave with integrity, not only in terms of our franchise partners, but also with regard to our shareholders who invest big money with us. And you know, this humility thing is interesting. Is that when I met this Greek family probably 15 years ago, and we started to put all this corporate stuff into the business. I mean, I kid you not when I say that two of them probably still can't talk English well. So I said to them, Peter, Funny, Johnny, Perry, you know, all these, you've got all these outsiders coming into the business here. And so, I mean, you know, you guys are the family, you started this. So what's the kind of legacy that you want to leave behind? Or what's not negotiable for these young Turks who want to come in here and turn your business upside down? And they said to me in their own broken English, which I then kind of articulated in this way, is they said, Kevin, as long as this business will always stand for hard work and honest endeavor, we'll be very happy as a family. And so that's how humble they are. And so we always want to make sure we stand for humility, hard work, and honest endeavor. So that's the glue that holds the famous band's team together. And if I talk about this thing about wanting to diversify, we had to put it in a sentence. And so we said is that the diversification program is about from winning in food service franchising, which is where we think we've done a reasonable job. We never can say you won, but we've done a reasonable job, to winning in the leisure and the consumer product space. That's what I spend a lot of my time on these days, in terms of what's the next big thing for famous brands? What's going to move the needle in terms of profits, share price, market capitalization? So if I can summarize that, famous brands, I think that our strategy has delivered in the short term, and it's certainly built for the long term. We built to last, another great Jim Collins book. We don't do things that are about tomorrow, we're here for the long term. And I think the fact that the family to this day are still 32% shareholders in this business tells you that this is a business that's here for the long haul. We're not getting in and getting out because at the boom of a share price. We see significant revenue and margin opportunities ahead. We honestly believe that in the food service space, GDP growth dependent, is that there's the ability to double the size of this business again. And I often talk about that when I talk to our franchise partners at franchise conferences, and some of them come to me, a lot of them come to me and say to me, damn it, Kevin, you know, I remember you talking about famous brands when the share price was 10 rand. And I thought, oh, I don't know if this is a true story. And that price seems high, 10 rand. And today it's 115. I said, why didn't I listen to you? Instead of going to work 7 days a week behind accounting stairs, I should have just bought shares for famous brands. So we think that this business is built for the long term and there's still strong growth ahead. We're leveraging our scale and our skills. We want to diversify. We've got a strong balance sheet. We've got great leadership. They're all ambitious. And so we want to increasingly leverage that scale and our skills and build this business into something beyond just food service. I can brag a bit, I think we're strong, I think we're resilient, and I think what we do have is a lot of confidence. Because we're optimistic about the future, and I think we have every reason to. So I hope that you know a little bit more about famous brands than you did when you got here this morning. And I used to ask you if you've got any questions, but in the event that there aren't, I just want to again thank you for inviting us here today. It's a real privilege to talk to you guys. Involved in the education business, and I hope that you have a successful conference the rest of the day, and that for all of you, you have a great academic year. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. I hope that why you reference SEB as the best use of school anymore.
I suppose it's emotional. Yeah, it is. I mean, you know, it's ironic. How many people at Famous Brands are actually ex-SAB? Group HR director, Pauline, she's ex-SAB. I fetched her. So if you walk around Famous Brands today, you'll see smatterings of SAB all over the show. In fact, people come there and say, we know where this comes from. So I say SAB was my business school because, as I was introduced, I am an individual that has a Buddha matric. I don't have anything other beyond that. I'm self-taught, and SAB made me what I am today. But I think, I suppose, if you went and asked some of the Famous Brands people, they'll probably tell you that it's not too shabby a business school either. I hope that answers your question. Yeah.
Are you able to expand a little bit on
your
leisure options
and
possibilities?
Yeah. No, I mean, I get asked that question all the time because they say you're trying to duck us now, Kevin, especially in the marketplace. They say leisure sounds like it's very vague. So, yeah, we say that for us, leisure is about probably hospitality, probably beverages, although we're not about to go and get involved in the beer business because they give us a blood nose. It's probably about FMCG, and if we get bottled, we'll probably have a look at retail. Now, we've put our toe in the water with retail. Some of you, if you've read the editorial, is that we've done a transaction whereby we have the right of use of a well-known retail trademark in South Africa called Thrups, and we've taken the Thrups brand and we're putting it on the forecourt of Total Service Stations, and that's been a phenomenal success. So it's the, if you, South Africa, you've got Engen, Woolworths, and you've got Pick and Pay, and BP, I think. You've got Caltex and Fresh Stop. The Total people have said, look, this Bonjour thing means nothing. So you Famous Brands guys, you're quite clever, but if you can, you come and bring us a model. So we took them Thrups, and it's worked phenomenally well. So if we're brave enough, we'll roll the retail out. But I mean, it is about hospitality, beverages, FMCG, and retail. Terminology, they say Debonair's pizza is like like the Johnny Walker Black with whiskey. And what we do is, and guess what is the biggest selling pizza? Chicken. So that's how we're having the fight. Without being chicken, we're selling a lot of chicken. Good question, eh? Sorry, yeah.
What are your main competitors?
Who are our main competitors?
Yes.
Sure. We like to say we're in the share of throat business. Yeah, but I think you've got to look at it in terms of category. I mean, if you talk about burgers, it's McDonald's. Although we don't like to directly compare ourselves with McDonald's, but in the value space, certainly they are. More recently now, Burger King have done a phenomenal job. So if you talk about pizza, it's been about Romans. It's now about Domino's. It's about Pizza Hut. So within every category, there's a fierce competitor. With Wimpy at Spur or the Spur Trade more than our time. So, but there's one thing about this food service landscape, it is highly competitive. South Africans are spoiled for choice. Surprise, the hand up over there.
Craig, do you see this load shedding as an opportunity to get more people out of home eating, or as a threat for your manufacturing?
Yeah, it's a good question, and it hurts. I mean, if you talk about our business. I mean, that's what the media asked me last year about load shedding. And the difference with our business is that if you're going to a shopping center and you're going to go buy a pair of shoes and the lights are out, so I'll go back tomorrow because I know the shoes I want to buy. But if you're coming to, if you're going to Mugget Bean and the lights are out, you're not coming twice tomorrow. It's gone. So load shedding is a big threat for our business. People will probably stay at home and dry.
Because, I mean, if everyone's lights are out, I mean, I was there during load shedding, I think 2 days ago, and we went to, unfortunately, a competitor of yours.
I'm leaving, wow. Sorry, yeah.
But it's a jam pack, so, yeah. So, you know, when people can't cook at home, it must be a huge opportunity for
us. It's got its upside and downside. Debbie, am I finished? Where are you?
Here I am.
Yep. Shopping centres. I mean, I live in Bedford View at Bedford Centre, which you probably don't want to go there, you get shot these days. There is no generator, and then you go to a little centre down the road called Village View and you can't find a parking. So, what it does do is that consumers become very mobile.
I was in Durban in December and I saw the circular clothes had pizza like little Pizza Hut little vendors. Is it becoming like, would that be under leisure?
Yeah, we've seen that model, and I mean, we've spoken to Stair Clinical. I mean, I love movies, as does my wife, but I mean, I think if you go to movies, and maybe you guys are different, but I mean, for me, the worst part about going to movies is trying to get popcorn or Coke or something to eat. I mean, it's a fiasco. So we've gone to Stair Clinical and said, listen, why don't you let us take that side of your business, and we'll turn it into absolutely a pleasurable experience. And we think there's a significant opportunity there. So you're obviously great at marketing, so that's the type of thing we're talking to Stair Clinical about. We can see a brand like Milky Lane on the forecourts of Stair Clinical's selling more than just Coke and popcorn, milkshakes, soft serve, waffles, the whole experience. And we think that'll drive more people into the cinemas because it's a better experience. So it's something to look at. It's a great opportunity about, I spoke about trading formats, taking your route to market and making sure that you're always accessible. Movie Place is a great opportunity. Pizza Hut has done a good job in Durban. It's a flip. Pavilion, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here we go. Your human resources and more specific your core values is you have people there from the banking sector, you have yourself coming from SAP. Is that also an indication perhaps of maybe conglomerates in the near future? Some of those partners?
You said that the nature of our board.
Yeah.
Are you talking about the Sunday workers of the world?
Yes.
Yeah, look, I do think what we've done is that we're doing two things. Is we're transforming our board because it's the right thing to do. And at the same time, though, is we're bringing skills onto the board that we didn't have. I mean, when I started there, all five of the family members were board members. And so, you know, the conversations were good for those days, but the world has moved on. And they accept it. They're non-exec directors today, but we're bulking up. So what we are doing is bringing people onto the board of the likes of Asante Puerta, Norman Adamy joins our board, ex-SAB. In February, and we're delighted about that. What we want to do is to help get those people to add real value to us in terms of how we take this business forward. Because, I mean, you know, you can, in beta, you can get store blind. We used to do the same thing all the time. You're always looking for people from outside to come and give you another opinion. And Santi's been great.
Sorry, I just wanted to ask, the book you mentioned,
yeah.
where is it available from?
I think you get it exclusive books.
Thank you.
You can download it
I
as
have
well.
Phoned, you can download, sorry Kevin, I have phoned, if you phone the central exclusive books number, the 0860, they will tell you where in South Africa the book is available. There are not many, so like Russ says, I suggest you rather get it online.
Kindle.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.